life where he had to reject everything material. Brahmana, the normal respect in society. But he was completely transcendental to the world. And still he practiced spiritual life. How he learned from everyone, everywhere. That is described through that narrative. Now, he was certainly an extraordinary person. And how people who are not that extraordinary can grow in spiritual life will be described now. So I will focus on one metaphor throughout the class. And the theme of this class will be, what is the role of Varnashrama in bhakti? How do the two correlate? The metaphor will be that we need to focus on replicating the takeoff, not recreating the takeoff point. Now when a plane has to fly, at that time the plane needs a takeoff point. The plane has to have a place where it can fly smoothly on the ground, gain momentum, and then take off spiritually. So the takeoff point is required for a plane to fly in the sky. But suppose we have one particular airport in Mumbai, and say some other smaller city relatively speaking, like Nasik, an airport is to be built. Now the topography, the surface structure of Nasik is different from Mumbai. So we cannot have the same takeoff, entirely the same takeoff point there. Or if we consider some hill station, some place like Mathera or somewhere like that, where a takeoff point is to be created, then it would not be the same as what was there in Mumbai. The important thing is not to replicate the exact same geography or the topography of the takeoff points in two places. The essential point is that we should take off. The plane should be able to fly in the sky. So the social structure of Varnashrama is like the takeoff point. And the process of bhakti yoga is like the takeoff. So bhakti yoga is the process for raising our consciousness from the material level to the spiritual level. It is the process that enables us to ultimately go out of this world and to attain Krishna. Varnashrama helps us to live harmoniously in this world. And the two can be connected and the two can be entirely disconnected also. So the Bhagavatam clearly mentions that Atha Pumbir Dujasreshta Varnashrama Vibhagasa Sunishtasya Dharmasya Samsiddhir Naritoshanam. The purpose of Varnashrama is to satisfy Lord Hari. And satisfying Lord Hari is the essence of devotional service. So when we satisfy Lord Hari, we receive His mercy and then we become attracted to Him. And ultimately we attain Him. And then the Bhagavatam also says that Shrama Eva Hi Kevalam. In the same section, 1.2.6-22, where the process of devotional service is talked about, Dharma Sunishta Pumsam Vishvaksena Kathasuya No Utpade Yadiratim Shrama Eva Hi Kevalam. So if one performs Varnashrama Dharma but one does not develop attraction to the Lord, then that performance of duties according to Varnashrama is Shrama Eva Hi Kevalam. So if we elaborately put in a lot of efforts to build a takeoff point, but then we have no airport, we have no pilot, and nobody is taking off from there, then what is the use? So the important thing is that the takeoff point should be used for the purpose of takeoff, taking off. And interestingly, if you consider bodies that fly in the sky, helicopters don't require much of a takeoff point. Helicopter can just take off from wherever they are. So similarly, the previous verse describes a situation where somebody is so transcendental that they can just take off. Some people, their spiritual urge may be so strong that they do not need any supportive social structure. They can just march off spiritually. Purvabhya senate naiva riyate yavashopi saha jigyasurapi yogasya shabda brahmati vartate. In 6.43, 44, 45, when Krishna talks about how the yogis who have practiced spiritual life in one life and then they resume their spiritual practice in the next life. Because for them, it said that Shabda Brahma Ativartate, Ativartate. They go beyond Shabda Brahma. Shabda Brahma is the range of Vedic sound. Vedic sound basically describes Varanashram, the system of how we should live materially by which you can progress spiritually. But for them it is Purva Abhyasena Tenaiva. Because of the Purva Abhyas, the past practice, Riyateya Avashopisaha. That one is helplessly, forcefully attracted towards the Supreme Lord. Attracted towards transcendence. Attracted towards something higher in life. So for them, they already have innately the energy to just take off. Just like helicopter is constructed in such a way that it can just take off without much of a takeoff on the ground. Just picks up. So like that, some souls are special, and because of their past spiritual cultivation, they have the potency that wherever they are, they will take off. That leave alone needing a supportive social structure, they can even go against the social structure to surrender to the Lord and to pursue their spiritual growth. However, most people are not like that. And for them, there is a takeoff that is needed. So if we consider the history of our movement, the first generation, many of the souls who were sent by Krishna to assist the Prabhupada, you could say were like helicopters. You know, they had their own spiritual search going on so strongly even before they were introduced to Krishna. And they just marched off. So Srila Prabhupada started the Krishna consciousness movement without much of a takeoff point. Now wherever people were from there, just start off. Just start off practicing. There are many great souls who are actually seriously searching for something higher. Some of the illustrious followers of Srila Prabhupada actually went out in search of God to different parts of the world. If we consider most of us, at least I didn't go out in search of God. Devotees came out in search of me. And they found me. Of course, even in our case, there has to be some spiritual inclination which is there, or some spiritual inclination that was activated somehow. But the point is that the first generation in our movement was like a helicopter taking off. And not even the whole first generation. Srila Prabhupada, even when the movement was very small, one of the first things that he did was created the governing body commission. He delegated authority. And then he emphasized, as the years spread, that we need a supportive social structure by which people can grow spiritually. So, most helicopter usually is very small. Helicopter cannot carry 100-200 people. So similarly, there is one person or a very small group of people who are all very spiritually motivated, then in whatever situation they may be put, they will be able to practice spiritual life. They will just be like helicopters taking off from wherever they are. But if we have a large community of people who want to practice spiritual life, then we cannot expect them to take off without a proper takeoff point. That community becomes like a plane. And for a plane to take off, we need a proper takeoff point. And that, now what do we mean by having a takeoff point to move towards spirituality? Normally, we consider the material and the spiritual to be different. And sometimes we say the material has to be given up to practice the spiritual. However, the bhakti process is not just about giving up the material for practicing the spiritual. It is also about using the material for practicing the spiritual. It is, if we consider The Bhagavad Gita does tell Arjuna, Sarvadharman parityajya mamekam sharanam raja. Says, give up all varieties of religion and just surrender unto me. And yet, at the end of the Bhagavad Gita, what does Arjuna do? Does he just give up Sarvadharman, all dharmas? I was at a Bhagavad Gita program, a general Hindu program, and there I was invited to talk on the Bhagavad Gita. And there some of the children over there in that community, they were reciting the Bhagavad Gita, some important verses. And they came to this 18.66 and they recited, Sarva Adharman Parityajya Mamekam Sharanam Raja. So they recited as Sarva Adharman Parityajya. Now, after that, I asked the organizer, this verse is Sarvadharma. How did you make it Sarvadharma? He said, actually, he quoted some Bhagavad Gita scholar who has said that actually Krishna has come to establish Dharma, Dharma Samsthapanarthaya. So, how can he tell you to give up Dharma? Actually, when the Bhagavad Gita was written down generation after generation, somebody forgot an oh. So, that's why now we have added that O. It is actually meant to be Sarva Dharma Antaritvaj. Now, logically, it might make sense. But it completely misses out on the context of the Bhagavad Gita. For Arjuna, Adharma was not an option at all. If you see the beginning of the Bhagavad Gita, there is an ethical tension. But there is a moral tension and an ethical tension. Moral tension means, one choice is moral, the other is immoral. And one needs at that time willpower to stick to the moral choice. If somebody is tempted by money, somebody is tempted by sensuality, no, I won't do this. That's moral tension. Ethical tension is where there are two choices, both of them are good. But which is good at that particular situation? So Arjuna had to choose between his Kshatriya Dharma and his Kula Dharma. The Kshatriya Dharma told him that aggressors have to be fought and have to be defeated, have to be punished. His Kula Dharma told him that you should always protect the members of your Kula. So, before the Kurukshetra war, his Varana Dharma and his Kula Dharma went into opposite directions. So, here also it says Varanashrama Kula Acharam. Here it says Varanashrama and Kula, one should work according to both of them. Samacharet, one should work accordingly. But for Arjuna, there was a tension between the two. So which to choose? Should he choose his Kshatriya Dharma, which is Varana Dharma, or his Kula Dharma? And Krishna tells him, don't get caught in whether this Dharma is important, that Dharma is important. Remember, the purpose of all Dharma is Mamekam Sharanam Braja, surrender to me. And find out which Dharma helps you to surrender to me. And in Arjuna's situation, it was the Chatvarana Dharma. For establishing Krishna's purpose of establishing Dharma, he had to fight. And that's why Arjuna at the end of the Bhagavad Gita is described, Yatra Yogeshwara Krishna Yatra Partho Dhanurdharaha. He has picked up his bow in readiness to fight. So, the point I was making here is that even for Arjuna, at that time, the takeoff point was not so smooth. But the important thing is, when the Bhagavad Gita tells in principle Arjuna, give up everything for the surrender of Krishna. But actually, Arjuna surrenders according to his Varana Dharma. He surrenders by fighting the war. So basically, bhakti has two aspects. One is the world transcending aspect, and the other is the world engaging aspect. So there are things in this world which cannot be dovetailed in Krishna's service. Say for example, there are activities which break the regulative principles. They are explicitly non-devotional or even anti-devotional. They have to be given up. But there are many activities in the world which are pro-devotional. And they can be used in the service of Krishna. So if we consider the takeoff point, it is on the ground. The plane is meant to fly in the sky. But as the plane starts taking off, it moves on the ground, and as it keeps moving faster and faster and faster on the ground, it gains the momentum. And then it is inclined upwards. And as it inclines upwards, it then shoots out into the sky. So similarly for us, when we want to move towards Krishna, there is the spiritual energy that comes from our attraction to Krishna. Now for most of us, there is definitely some attraction towards Krishna. But that attraction is sporadic. It is not consistent. So what Varnashrama does, so if a plane is to move, it needs some fuel, it needs some energy. So if we are to move, we have to have some energy. Where will that energy come from? In one sense, it may come from our attraction towards Krishna. But that is not very strong at this stage. Then we could say it can come from our intellectual conviction. This is what I am meant to do. Jiva Goswami says that for the sadhaka, for the siddha, siddha stays on the spiritual platform by their priti. The sadhakas stay on the spiritual platform by their buddhi. Evam buddhe param buddhva. In 3.43 Krishna says, in this way, and with your intelligence, understand yourself to be transcendental. Samstabhyatmanam atmana. With this, situate yourself on the spiritual platform. But at the same time, that same third chapter, this is 3.43, say 8 verses earlier, 3.35 Krishna says that that everybody acts according to their nature. That nigraha kim karishyati. Sadrushim cheshtate swasya prakritir jnanavanapi prakritim yanti bhutani nigraha kim karishyati. So he says that even jnanavan, even those in knowledge will act according to their nature. What can repression accomplish? So what he means over here is that our buddhi we are meant to use to ensure that we go out spiritually. But even when we are going spiritually, we cannot repress our nature. So that nature is what is channeled by Varnashrama. So Varnashrama basically channels our material energy in a dharmic way. We all have certain material interests, certain material talent, certain material abilities. And those are channeled in a constructive way for social and spiritual growth. So the social harmony and the social contribution is taken care of Varnashrama. And bhakti takes care of the spiritual growth. So basically, a brahmana would like to do intellectual work. A kshatriya would like to do managerial work. So by like to do, we are not talking simply here about some superficial liking of the mind. The mind is not, you could say, monochrome. In the yoga literature, it is said that there are three levels of the mind. We call it the outer mind, the middle mind, and the inner mind. So the outer mind refers to that aspect of the mind which is connected with the gross body. The middle mind refers to the subtle body itself. And the inner mind refers to that aspect of the mind which is connected with the Atma, the soul. So the outer mind refers to how our mind's emotions are shaped by are connected with our physical situation. Now when we become angry or when we become agitated, we start breathing fast. And conversely, if we are agitated and if we start breathing slowly, then just by the slow breathing, the mind calms down. Not fully, because there are impurities which are there in the middle mind, which also have to be dealt with. But the outer mind is very strongly connected with the body. So the impressions that we carry, so at the level of the outer mind, there are many emotions that may come. Somebody will look at a sense object and I want this, I want that, I want that. So at the level of the outer mind, there are many desires that may come and go. And those are superficial. They are there one moment and then after some time they are forgotten. I was once traveling in North India, going for a youth meeting or youth retreat in Varanasi. So I was sitting in the train, at that time I was traveling many years ago, and I was chanting. And I was chanting, at that time one person he asked, Swami, you have a question. I want to ask some questions. I said, I'm busy now, later. He says, where are you busy? He says, I'm chanting. He says, you can chant anytime. You can chant anytime. He said, no, I'll talk with you later. So I finished my japa and I said, yes, what was your question? He said, I forgot the question. So actually it was not at all a serious question for him. He just saw somebody and asked a question. But just half an hour later he forgot the question. So this is just very, this is very superficial curiosity. Sometimes we see something, maybe ask a question. But there is also existential curiosity. Now where one needs certain answers to make sense of life. So basically I am saying that at the mind's level there are superficial desires which come and go. But at the middle mind level there are also deeper desires, deeper inclinations, deeper attractions. These are what we could say, what we could say is our varna nature, our swabhava. So the swabhava is not something that can be wished away. It is something very deep rooted within us and we need to channel that constructively in Krishna service. And to the extent the swabhava is channeled, to that extent we get momentum. Even in material life, there is a great concern many people have. They want to get into their flow, want to find their shape, they want to discover their purpose. Now when they are talking about discovering their purpose, we say yes, our purpose is to go back to Krishna. So they are not interested in that purpose. That is okay. What is it? Okay, what is my purpose while I am living here? What am I meant to do in my life? And it's a very serious search. And for many people, they just don't find out what is their nature, what are their inclinations. And people who can find it out, they actually, materially speaking, are happier than others. Material happiness doesn't last for long, but there are even material level, material happiness also at various levels. There could be just material happiness which comes by fulfilling our vasanas. Now lust, anger, lust, greed, and when we fulfill that, there is some pleasure. But there is also a vritti, varna, brahman, kshatriya, vaishya. So when we live according to our basic nature, we also get some happiness there. And people who are able to do anything worthwhile, anything extraordinary in the material level of reality, material life also, they basically are channeling their basic nature. I studied engineering. So in engineering, there are most people who are just functional. They're just in the engineering to get a degree and get a job. But there are some people who just love the subject. Just keep studying, getting absorbed in that. And they do it because it engrosses them so much. That's because that is more or less their nature. So many people spend a lot of trying to find their nature, even in the material world. And if they find it, they get, relatively speaking, some material happiness. If they don't find it, then there is extreme dissatisfaction, which just plagues them. So now when we are practicing spiritual life, we can't wish away our material body and our material mind. We have to find out how we are meant to move forwards in our spiritual life. And for that, if we can channel our material nature and its energy. So we want to move towards Krishna. One way is the attraction towards Krishna that will help us move. The other is the intellectual conviction. So intellectual conviction is important for fighting against the vasanas, fighting against lust, anger, greed. But the intellectual conviction cannot suppress the swabhava, the basic nature. Nigraha kim karishyasi, Arjuna, Krishna is asking Arjuna. Okay, Arjuna, you are a kshatriya. If you try to be forgiving, if you try to be non-violent, you are acting like a brahmana. You won't be able to act like that. Therefore, it says act according to your nature. So the principle is that in Varnashram, there is the material energy which we get when we act according to our nature. And that material energy is used to create spiritual momentum. That is used to help us not just move materially on the horizontal plane, but move horizontally and then take off vertically. So when we work according to our swabhava, according to our nature, we move forwards in our spiritual life much more smoothly, because there is some inner friction that is there, because we have to fight against our lower desires. But then there is also the spiritual, there is also the inner harmony that is there because we are working according to our nature. Now this, of course, brings us to the ever-present question that just as that is, which is asked by materialistic people, that is also asked by devotees. How do we find our nature? How do we understand what is our nature? The first principle there is that we generally can't understand our nature so easily unless we are having some very special talent and have some special circumstance which reveal that talent to us. The mind in Rajoguna is always looking for something new, something new, something new. So if you ask the mind means I talked about the outer mind, the middle mind, the inner mind. And normally it is the outer mind that is active very much. If you ask the mind, what is my nature? The mind will reply, whatever you are doing right now, that is not your nature. All that it will say is, oh, you are doing right this? This is so miserable, this is so incompatible, this is so frustrating. This is not your nature. And then whatever we do, the mind will keep us dissatisfied in that. Because the point is that the mind always likes the path of least resistance. It doesn't want to work hard. It doesn't want to apply oneself. And even when we are working very hard, even when we are doing something which we like to do, the mind is so fickle that it sometimes doesn't like even that thing which it normally likes to do. So for example, I like to write. Writing is the time when I get most absorbed. But there are times when writing is so difficult. There's one devotee long ago, many I mean 10-12 years ago, one devotee told me, he says, your service is very nice. We just sit in the room and write. He says, we have to run around, manage this, solve this problem, do this, do that. Then what happened? He had to give his exam. He had to give his Bhakti Shastri. And he had to write essays. And he had to write those essays for 3 days. And he said, I don't want to do this ever again. So anything that we have to do, just sit down, write, organize the thoughts. It's not that easy. So the nature of the mind is, it makes us feel like what others are doing are so easy. It's so easy. So an author has said that writing is very easy. All you have to do is sit in front of a computer and glare at the monitor till drops of blood form on your forehead. Till drops of blood form on your forehead. That means no ideas come. You don't sweat over there. You get so frustrated. So there are times when authors just feel, I don't ever want to write. So one of the most prolific authors in the world, he had a policy. How did he write? He said every morning he would go into his library and he would just take off his outer clothes and he would give them to his butler. And he said till noon, he said, don't give me these clothes back. I cannot come out of the room till noon. And even if he didn't feel like writing, he kept writing. The point which I am making over here is that even if we are doing something that we like to do, even if something is according to our nature, it is not that the mind will always like to do it. So that's why for understanding our nature also, we need to go beyond the outer mind. The outer mind is always filled with circumstantial emotions. Hey, I like this, I don't like that, I want to eat this, I want to watch this, I want to do that. So the process of bhakti initially involves learning the principle of subordination, learning the principle of obedience, by which whether I feel like it or don't feel like it, I do it. That's why Vaidhi Bhakti is, we are given the Vidhi by the Shastra, by the Guru. And when we act accordingly, then basically we learn to go beyond the outer mind. The outer mind is where our circumstantial emotions, temptations, cravings, all these keep coming. And when we go beyond the outer mind, then we can go to the middle mind. The middle mind is where our swabhava is situated. And then we can discover that and we can persevere in that. So to the extent we work according to our nature, our material energy becomes channeled for our spiritual purposes. Because if it's only the spiritual attraction towards Krishna, that is to take us towards Krishna, the energy will not be much. But if we are doing something which we like to do, not again like in a superficial sense, but in a substantial sense. Somebody just loves to sing for Krishna. They can go on lifelong singing for Krishna. Somebody loves to manage, organize things, and they get to do it for Krishna. They'll be happy to do it. So when this is the point of Varnashrama, that we are meant to take people that their material energy can be used to power their spiritual journey. That is the expertise of Varnashrama. Now I started by talking about how there is, our purpose is to replicate the takeoff, not recreate the takeoff point. I'll conclude with that explanation, that what determines, I mean, say when we work according to our swabhava, according to our material nature, then we can move towards Krishna with greater energy. But what determines our swabhava? What determines our nature? Is it birth only? Is it, for like birth means that say we are born in a particular dynasty, particular family, particular national, particular country, particular gender, particular socio-cultural context. That birth is definitely an important factor. But the mistake of Varnashrama was to reduce swabhava to janma. Janma, birth, does contribute to determining my swabhava. Now, at the time of the Varana, the Bhagavad, at the time of the Mahabharata itself, there is a celebrated conversation between Yudhishthira and Nahusha. And Nahusha, Nahusha is asking questions to Yudhishthira. Yudhishthira says that actually, because there has been an intermixing of the Varanas for so long, we cannot determine the Varana just by Janma. And therefore, ultimately, we have to look at Achara. What is the person? How does the person act? That is what will determine the Varana. Now, he is talking about intermixing thousands of years ago when the Mahabharata was spoken. The Mahabharata describes a culture, but it is not necessarily the ideal Vedic culture. Krishna speaks the Bhagavad Gita and he says, I am speaking this because there is Dharmasya Glani. Now, where is the Dharmasya Glani? At that time, the Dharmasya Glani was there. So, the decline of Dharma is the setting in which the Mahabharata was occurring. And Krishna came to establish Dharma. So, thousands of years ago, if the Janma alone was not, birth alone was not enough to determine the Varana, the nature, what to speak of now? So, basically, our Achar is determined by five factors. There is Janma, there is the birth, then there is the Poshana. Poshana is our upbringing. How are we brought up? And that has to be very carefully understood. Because our Poshana, it creates a substantial amount of impressions within us. And then beyond that is our Sangha, our association. Even if somebody has got a very good upbringing, good karma from the past, but still if they get into bad association, they will start acting in a bad way. Ajamil is the example of that. Beyond that, there is Svechha. We all have our free will. And lastly is Krupa, is mercy. So our Janma which determines our, which indicates our Purva Karma, the samskaras created from Purva Karma. Our Janma, our Poshana, our Sangha, our Svechha and Krupa. So our Janma, Poshana and Sangha, they push us in particular directions. And it is our Svechha, we can go in that direction or to some extent we can resist that. So somebody, for example, how Poshana may affect, somebody maybe from childhood may be just involved in eating meat. And that's just natural for them. But then if they understand, this is what animals go through. There's one Western thinker, he said, if slaughterhouses had windows, and nobody would kill animals, nobody would eat meat. is just not aware of it. But if they come to know about it, now in India, even now, in many movies and contemporary culture, he said if you have to become modern, you should eat meat. But in the Western world, actually eating meat is old fashioned. If you want to become cool, if you want to become trendy, become a vegan. Stop eating meat. So that culture changes. But the point is, we have swichha. The past may have created a certain kind of inclinations within us. So these things, our janma, our poshana and our sangha, these create propositions. Come on, do this, do this, do this. Now, we always have free will whether to accept the proposition or not accept the proposition. But if a person has always eaten meat and they have no reason not to eat meat, then they just accept the proposition. Now, some people may understand, I don't want to eat meat because it is causing so much pain to animals. But still the desire may be very strong. That's so our by our swechha, we can fight against the force from the past. But sometimes the force from the past may be too strong, or from the present also, sangha associated in the present also. But what kripa does is, kripa does two things. First is, it makes our swechha strong. It increases our willpower. And it decreases the power of the past. The samskaras that are there within us, they stop troubling us that much. And in both of these ways, our behavior can change. So bhakti is dramatically powerful in empowering our swechha and in disempowering our past influences. So bhakti empowers us to go past our past. To go past our past, whatever our past may be. Now for us, when we are talking about when you say go past our past, that we are talking primarily in terms of the vasanas, the outer mind, where there are this craving, that craving, that is there. But from our past, we also get our swabhava. So swabhava also is not determined by the purva janma alone. It is determined by the poshana, by the upbringing also. And that's why to understand one's swabhava, one has to look holistically at the person. One of the key points of conflict between the first world and the third world is the role of women in society. Where I just came from America and UK, for 3 months I was there. I came yesterday morning itself. So one of the common images in the Western media about India is, oh, just see how these people, these Indians, they put down their women. They abuse their women, they torture their women, there is so much violence against women. Now, actually speaking, to some extent it is true and it is horrible the way things happen. But in America also, now there is a huge campaign called Me Too. Me Too campaign is that there are several women who have said that they were harassed in their workplace. That in order to grow in their profession, their bosses extracted sexual favors from them. And there was a Nobel Academy Award winning movie director whose Academy Award was taken away because he had exploited many women, many famous Hollywood actresses that way. So the principle that there is the sexual force which will be abused, that is universal. But the point is that this is how it is depicted in the Western world. So now one of the defining differences between the first world and the third world is, what is the role of women? And Srila Prabhupada, so in the Western world it is considered that women also have to have autonomy. That they should be able to do what they want to do. And that's how they're from some childhood itself, they are grown up like that. Now Prabhupada talks strongly about how women should always be under the protection. But then what does protection mean? Protection does not mean restriction. Protection means facilitation. Facilitation so that everybody can grow accordingly. There are lectures where Prabhupada says that, or in a conversation with Prabhupada, he says that the Western women are different. Now, they have in Chaitanya Charan purport, he says, right from their childhood, they have been born and brought up to be just like their brothers. And he says, in our movement, these brothers and sisters, they are all doing wonderful service to Krishna. The Prabhupada wanted Varnashram, but at the same time, Prabhupada sent out devotees for distribution. And devotees means even women went out for distribution. Like Prabhupada had wanted Varnashram in a rigid sense of women always under protection. Well, a woman is going out all alone to distribute books, where is the protection? Prabhupada did not restrict people. He doted people. So basically, if you see Prabhupada, when he preached and engaged people, it was according to their portion. Since women who had been born and brought up in a traditional setting. In a traditional setting, who had been trained to take up the traditional social role of women, he encouraged them to do that. And those who had been born and brought up in a setting where they had been trained differently, he engaged them according to their nature. The principle of protection is always there, but how it is applied will vary according to time, place, circumstance. Last year, when I was in Denver, we had gone to a program. And it was a college program, so there are a couple of brahmacharis who conduct that program. And actually, it's not last year, it was the year before that. So, there were some students who came for the program. In the West, gender separation is almost impossible, especially in college outreach. So, there were boys and girls also there for the program. So, I gave my class is normally quite philosophical. So, the first question, after I finished my class, I explained about various things. The first question a girl asked, she says, all of you are monks. Where are the nuns? No, she didn't ask any other question, nothing about the philosophy. Where are the nuns? So I just look at the two devotees over there, they're black. So then I answered, actually, you know, we have a small center here. And we have some monks over here. We have, so in Delhi, we have a big center in LA where we have facility for nuns also. And I said, if you want to start a facility for nuns, you are welcome, you can start over here. Now, I just spoke that in a joke. But this year, when I had gone to one center, that same Mataji said, you know, you had come for that program. That Mataji was in the temple now, she was serving as a brahmachari. So, the point is that this is what people look at. This is what people look at. They have a particular vision. They say that, okay, why do you have only monks over here? So then after that, those devotees, whenever they go for a program, they always take some Matajis with them for the program. So the devotee will give the class, the Mataji will do the kirtan. And they say, okay, there are men and there are women. So they say, if you see there are only men, then people get put off. People just, not just women feel, what is this? Is this only a men-only project? But also men also, they start thinking, in the Western world is so, if there is any establishment with only men, people start thinking that, you know, these are not straight people. When they are of a particular sexual orientation, that's why there are only men over here. There are no women over here. So people have their own mind frame which they come. And we need to channel it accordingly. So basically, to the extent, whatever is people's portion. So another, I'll conclude as saying that we have to replicate the takeoff point. Replicate the takeoff, not recreate the takeoff point. So one very deep-rooted need which is created by the modern upbringing or the contemporary upbringing is the need for autonomy. People want to feel that I am my own person and I want to do what I want to do. And Prabhupada talks in the Ishopishad purport that every soul has his own initiative. And this initiative is meant to be used in Krishna's service. So the need for autonomy is a natural human need. We are souls who have been given free will by Krishna. So when the autonomy is suppressed repeatedly, then people just can't function. There is a disciplining required. The people who work in the army for many, many years, especially in lower positions, where they are simply told to obey. If they retire from the army after that, they just don't know what to do. Because they have never developed a responsibility for taking decisions. Just tell, they need someone to tell them what to do, what to do, what to do, what to do. Similarly, people who are in jails, you know, if even if they have somehow got into jail because of accidental crime or because of being framed or whatever. I was talking with a devotee in America who was in jail outreach. She's telling that many of them relapse, and they relapse not just because of bad association. If for many years they have stayed in jail, then they just need someone to tell them what to do. And if there is no one to tell them, then they don't know what to do. And that's why they go and join some gang where somebody will tell them what to do. So, you know, we all, Srila Prabhupada said, we have to become independently thoughtful. We give up our autonomy voluntarily to Krishna so that we can serve Him. But Krishna's love is such that He gives us our autonomy back. That means Krishna engages our free will in His service. It is not that we are meant to reject our free will, we are meant to use our free will in His service. And as a devotee grows spiritually, that need for autonomy is not taken care of, is not provided for, a devotee is not given a facility by which they can grow in devotional service, then they will not be able to move forwards in bhakti. To the extent this autonomy is provided for, to that extent the devotee will grow in spiritual life. And that, as we grow forwards, as we find out how best we can serve Krishna. Need for autonomy means what? And need to understand our nature and work according to our nature. So that when we do that, then we get satisfaction, which is both a combination of material and spiritual. It's material because of our nature. It's spiritual because it is done for Krishna. And that's how we move steadily towards Krishna. So I'll summarize. I spoke today about how in Varanashram we have to replicate the takeoff, not recreate the takeoff point. Started by an airplane, it needs a place to take off. A helicopter can take off on its own. So like that, those people who are already spiritually inclined or spiritually advanced from previous life, even without a supportive social environment, they can just take off. And that's how Srila Prabhupada started the moment in the first generation, with people who were already spiritually very motivated. But if there is a large community, hundreds of people are there, that can't fly like a helicopter, that needs a plane. And a plane needs a takeoff point. So traditionally the takeoff point was Varanashram. Varanashram means that we all have a particular material nature. If we don't work according to it, we feel very incompatibly situated and very dissatisfied. So we can move towards Krishna, the plane when it is to move towards Krishna, it can take off because of spiritual attraction towards Krishna. It can take off because of, it can get the energy because of intellectual conviction that I should go towards Krishna. But the spiritual attraction for most of us is not much. And the intellectual attraction, Krishna says, can't go against our basic nature. So, what will give energy to the plane to move on is psychophysical harmonization. When we harmonize with the psychophysical nature, then the energy that comes by working according to our material nature is used to move towards Krishna. Then, how do we discover this nature? For that, I talked about how there is the outer mind, which is connected with the body and the circumstances. The middle mind, which is where most of our deep-rooted impressions are stored. And then the inner mind, which is connected with the soul. So, if we rely on the outer mind, it will never allow us to be steady in anything. Even the things that we actually like to do according to our nature. So therefore, the first principle in trying to discover our nature is to learn subordination. Whatever I feel like doing, I put it aside and do what I am told to do. By that, we learn to go beyond the outer mind and we come to the middle mind, which is where we understand our nature. So when we come to the mode of goodness, then we start understanding, okay, this is what my deep-rooted inclinations. And so how do we determine this swabhava, deep-rooted inclination? Even in the time of Mahabharata, it was not simply by janma, because interbreeding leads to janma is not very strongly indicative of the purva samskara that we may have. So janma is one factor. Then there is poshana, the upbringing, and then there is the Sangha, the association. And there is Swechha and there is Kripa. So the Janma, Poshana and the Sangha, they create propositions. Do this. And the Swechha, by a free will, we can either accept or we can reject the proposition. And when we practice Bhakti and get Kripa, then our Swechha becomes stronger. And the Purva and the other factors, the negative forces coming from that become weaker. So the we are better able to resist the vasana. But the vritti, the basic swabhava, that is something which we are meant to channel. Krishna says, even the knowledgeable can't repress that. So our swabhava, basic nature is shaped not just by the our janma, but also large, significantly by our portion. Then I talked about the upbringing in today's world is such that there is a great need for autonomy that is created in people. It is always there because in Varnashrama also autonomy meant people work according to their nature. So I talked about how the social position of women and the depiction of women negatively in Western world, in the Western world about India. But it is there everywhere because everywhere people have vasanas by which the exploitation will happen. And that has to be combated. But then we talk about the poshana, if by the upbringing women have also been trained to be autonomous, then they have to be protected, but they also have to be given autonomy. And that's what Srila Prabhupada did when he engaged people in Krishna's service. And for us, the need for autonomy means that we do follow instructions, but we also learn about ourselves. So that even when, if in the future we are in a situation where we don't have an authority telling us what to do, then we won't become like retired army officers or released prisoners who just don't know what to do. By the steady practice of bhakti, under guidance, when we come to the mode of goodness, then we can understand what we are meant to do according to our nature, and we use that autonomy to increase our spiritual momentum. By which, when we work according to our nature, then the psychophysical harmonization gives us the energy for our spiritual elevation and our takeoff towards Krishna. Thank you very much. Hare Krishna. So, are there any questions or comments? So, Gantraj Srimad Bhagavatam ki, Srila Prabhupada ki, Gaur Bhakta Vrinda ki, Gaur Premanandi.